Adikada Bandura Jayasekara Samaga.
Good morning. My guest today is Vidya Atriya. She is a research associate, Center for Wildlife Studies and Wildlife Conservation Society, India program in Bangalore. Now, Vidya, welcome to Adikada.
Thank you.
Now, you work with leopards. Can you tell our viewers how you started and when you started and why you wanted to work with leopards?
So it was not as much as working on the leopards, but it was working on the issue where leopards share space with humans, where they are living in agricultural landscapes with humans. It's a very fascinating study then, because it's not only the leopards you're studying, but it's also the human dimension, how people are with these animals, because these are very old civilizations that we have. And they've always, what we found is that they have always shared space with wildlife. So if you're studying leopards in a national park, this human dimension doesn't come out. So, and it's a totally fascinating aspect.
But how could they share space? Because, I mean, the human beings are scared of them. They attack. That's the biggest issue.
So the biggest issue is that this is a construct very dominant in the media. Okay, which is not necessarily what it is on ground. Because if you have people who have been living in that landscape for, you know, 1,000, 2,000 years, and there's wildlife that has been living in that landscape for the same amount of time, what we are finding now is that they know about each other and they have learned, not in a, you know, not in a very thoughtful way, but over generations they have learned how to share space. So it's actually much more peaceful than what we see of it in the media.
How do they share space?
So for instance, the new term is called co-adaptation, where leopards, for instance, we radio collared leopards living in the agricultural landscape where human densities are 400 per square kilometer. We find that
leopards... Which part of India?
This is Maharashtra.
Yeah, Maharashtra, yeah. In Bombay. Yeah.
Near Bombay.
Near Bombay, yeah.
Yeah. So we found that these animals sit all day in the tall crops, sugar cane or maize, and they don't move at all. The night time when rural India sleeps, it's almost like wilderness then, because there are no humans. So that time these animals are active and then they go back and sit all day. So that is the adaptation from the leopard's point of view. But if you go to Yala or some other park, they are active even in the day. So they've learned to avoid people. And the people, on the other hand, they have like some of the adaptations people have is they know how to protect their livestock. They know what precautions to take. And what we found, to my greatest surprise, is many communities actually worship animals like leopards. So they know about these animals, they respect them. It's not a fearful interaction.
So it is not a fearful interaction.
It is not in these communities. So it's very important that there is this history of interaction. Because once you remove the animal, then the new people are really scared of something they don't know.
How many times, like, have you heard of leopard attacks in India?
Many, many times. There are many leopard attacks in India. But I think the problem is that because till recently, everybody thought wildlife should be in national parks. So it's only recently we are finding out, no, they've always lived among people. So we are not really equipped to deal with this situation as we should have been.
Yeah, but I say again, because the fear factor, the human beings would not attack a leopard, they'll try to avoid. But a leopard, you think they try to avoid, or they will attack if you meet?
No, so all wild animals are really scared of people. And leopards, for instance, in Sri Lanka or even in where I work, where there's no tiger or anything, the leopard is... We humans are their predators. We kill the leopard mortality... Greatest number of leopard mortality is due to human action, like snaring, poisoning. So we are actually their predators, and they're really, really scared of us.
They are?
Yeah. Their first response is to move away. They hear human voices and they move away.
So they would not, like unlike a tiger, they would not come to attack.
Even tiger doesn't attack. The only time they attack is when out of threat. Like the Bible, I attack you only if you are threatening me or my children. And that's what they also do.
Now, you're in Sri Lanka to deliver a speech, but have you traveled around?
Yeah.
Where did you go?
So, I went to the Central Highlands.
Yes.
Yeah, so near Hatton.
Hatton, yeah. Because there were lots of incidents, even we reported about these leopards being there. Did you spot any leopards or...?
No, but I went with the research team. There is researchers, Watson and Kittel, who are working there. So, we went to their study site.
Anjali Watson, she just won an award.
Award, yeah. She won the Whitley Award. Yeah. And I know them for a very long time. So, they showed us where they put up cameras. traps and their study site. And we also met the department officials there, and the tea garden management organized a talk, so we heard their experiences. So leopards are living there and have always been living
there. So what do they say, and what did you tell them in return?
So I just told them that this is a right time for Sri Lanka, where there is no problem, where you start taking proactive measures on how to deal with this situation that focuses on the safety of the people. Increase their understanding. Like, for instance, you are surprised that the leopard is scared of us.
Yes, definitely. I'm sure everyone is.
Yeah, so, but it's so important to tell people that they are really scared of you. So all this information sharing, collaboration between police, forest department, tea garden. So quite a lot of snaring happens in the tea gardens for the pigs, and the leopards are caught. So, and these are your Sri Lankan leopards, not found anywhere else on the planet.
Okay, that's interesting. Yeah. What do you think of Sri Lankan leopards, Vidya?
In what way?
How special are they?
So I think if I was Sri Lankan, I would be really proud that I have a different subspecies that is of my country. Yeah, so I think you should be pretty proud of them.
Why? Still, you know, it's because I'm sure my viewers will want to know, why is that? In comparison to the leopards in India, or what's...
So the thing is that if you wipe out the Sri Lankan leopards, you have lost a subspecies that you will not find anywhere else on the planet. It's like the Asiatic lion in India. It's been wiped out everywhere else, and it occurs only in Gujarat. And we are really proud of it. Okay, that we have managed to keep this animal despite all. So that's another thing I would like to tell you, that I think Sri Lanka and India are pretty unique because we have always shared spaces with wildlife. Like if you look at Norway and Sweden, they have densities of people of 20 people per square kilometer now. And they wiped out all their carnivores, 4 carnivores 100 years back. Whereas Indians have lived with wildlife, like even now we have the largest tiger population, the largest Asiatic only Asiatic lion population, the great Indian, I mean, so much biodiversity among a billion people. I mean, I'm happy to be an Indian.
So that way some of these countries lecture us on how to coexist, but we have done better than them.
We have lessons to teach them, if you ask me.
So what, and we want to tell the viewers what Vidya is saying, that this our leopard is very rare, that Sri Lankans should protect them.
And be proud of them.
And be protect and proud of them. Yeah. What have you heard about Yala?
So Yala, I've seen footage also taken long, amazing, because the leopards of Yala are so visible. Large cats are very secretive, so it's very hard to study them. We can't even look at them to understand. But Yala leopards are allowing people to look at them, and you know, therefore you can understand more about them. But I've also been hearing that like the tourism is a bit much, and India had that problem too in the tiger reserves. We had way more tourists than, you know, the department could handle, you know, because finally it's the tourism lobby which has to take the onus of it. Then we went to the Supreme Court, and then finally the Supreme Court has put guidelines on regulated tourism.
I'm coming to that now. Are you planning to visit Yala during a visit?
No, I'll come next time for a holiday if you take me there.
Of course, I'm sure. You are the Wildlife Association. Spencer will do that for you.
Sure.
But now about Yala. We have a problem. Okay, now my two questions. Why is that the leopards in Yala come out? Like you said, generally, why is that?
So we see it even in the tiger reserves in India, and some areas of leopards and the lions also. So I think wherever they know that these humans on vehicle, they learn over time, like a mother, father learn that, okay, they are not dangerous to us, they're just watching us, then they are not scared of us. Okay, but you get out of the car and it's a totally different dynamic.
Then what happens?
It's not safe then, because they don't know humans on foot.
Yes, so as long as they are on vehicles.
Yeah, so they don't know how to respond to humans on foot. So you, as long as you're in vehicle, you're fine.
Then there are chances of they attacking. If you...
I don't know.
In Yala, you're not allowed to, but still...
Yeah, no, I don't know if they'll attack. My guess is they'll move away, but you don't know what people will do. So I'm more worried about the people behavior than the leopards behavior.
Yeah, I've seen like, okay, Yala, I mean, they are on treetops and they are sleeping, or like, some of them are awake.
Right.
But... I mean, aren't we? I mean, I think it has become our people in Sri Lanka. We harass the elephant, we harass this. What do you propose? Are you going to have any interaction? I think, see, we spoke of tourism.
Right.
But this is damaging.
No, that is true. So somewhere there has to be regulation, but I don't see it entirely as damaging. The reason why so many people are going is because they are fascinated by these animals. Like even elephants, the reason all the time people are not chasing them, they're also watching. They're feeding because it's some kind of fascination. So that is very good because it fosters acceptance and tolerance of these animals, but there needs to be regulation.
But we Sri Lanka, now we got the largest animal on land, that's the elephant as well as the whales. But I have gone seen whale watching, you know, but I mean there's lots of harassment, I would say. They are blocking their paths. Now I've seen elephants trying to protect the babies. So there is so much of harassment, so one day we might lose them.
No, that is true, and I think then it is the responsibility of conservationists and media, if I may add, to give best practices out to the people and tell them that this is what you do and this is what you don't do. Be respectful of these animals. But it's something we need to tell the people. Without telling, you can't blame them.
Yeah, we keep informing them. But then, people are trying to, I would say, the wildlife department or the tourism, they want to make money. But they're trying to make so much of money, you might destroy this.
No, so regulations are important. So India, we had to go to the Supreme Court to get regulations. Yeah.
Can you explain how did it happen in India and about the regulations?
So as far as I know, in tiger reserves, a lot of tourism was going in, an unregulated huge number of vehicles. And the tourism lobby, see, the forest department is under great pressure because, you know, they get calls and they can't. And they are understaffed. I mean, there are not so many.
Calls from ministers, politicians.
Yeah. And tourism lobby is very, very powerful. So
in India.
In India. So then I think some, I don't know exactly who, but somebody went to the Supreme Court saying, you know, we need to stop tourism. And for nearly a few months, there was no tourism allowed in the tiger reserves. Then the Supreme Court came out and said, you have to have guidelines. So now you have to apply online. For your visitation, there are X number of vehicles that are allowed in. So it's very transparent and fair. And so it is nice.
No, I'm sure that I really want to tell you this. This is very important. Like you can't just, the other people go, you create traffic blocks.
Yeah.
Even in the Minnerie Park chaos. But in India, you can't do that. This is where we can learn a lot from India. You can apply only online.
Yeah, you can apply online and there's a certain number of vehicles. So if it's full, then you can't book for that day. You have to try another day.
So, but what if you don't have internet or you can't apply online?
In India, almost everything is going online. The current Prime Minister is really pushing digital payments. So
yeah, but then everybody can't speak English, but it's in local languages. In Hindi and
Or you
other
go
language.
To somebody and do it and the children know. So even on the phone, people use app. So it's phones are really, really ubiquitous now.
So is it working there?
It is much better than unregulated tourism.
So what have you, coming back to Sri Lanka, have you studied about Sri Lankan situation, the wildlife, what have you?
So what I find is your level of understanding related to the elephants is very, very good.
But this is a serious conflict.
No, it is, but it is also, I'm amazed, and I think you should also be, that so many people are living with these elephants and have always been living. And culturally, the elephant is deeply entrenched in your culture, right? So I think that is something to be proud of, to be celebrated.
Yeah, true, but I would like to blame the mankind. For that, because we go and clear their areas, have no other place to go. So I wouldn't blame the elephant for this.
No, definitely. But then for instance, in India, when you have mobs, okay, you have a mob around a leopard or an elephant. Earlier, it was just crazy. People were, you would go, they would get injured. But now, increasingly, we know that there are certain, for instance, there's a police rule 144. Which the collector can declare where no more than 5 people can gather. So in such a situation where wildlife is in a place where mobs can form, now more and more the police and the forest department know they can declare section 144. So these understandings are increasing. It's just that it's good that Sri Lanka is beginning to think about their leopards even when there is no problem at hand, because then you will not have a problem.
So I'm sorry, are we thinking? Sri Lankans are thinking. I know you have come to give a lecture, you have media interactions, but are we?
Yeah, I think they are increasingly thinking, and they are even planning to deliberate about it and bring out awareness and policy. And it's a really good time to do this, I think. I wish India had done it 30 years back.
We'll take a short break and we'll be back with you in a moment.
Bandura Jayasekara Samaga.
Welcome back to Pathikada. We are guest today is Vidya Athriya, when we are discussing about leopards in Sri Lanka and India. But before the break, Vidya, you were saying that the Sri Lankan example is good and I wish India did it before. But I think we need to, you need to elaborate on that to our viewers. Why?
Right. So in India, you know, there was much less problem about 30 years back. And then, you know, we weren't used to wildlife outside national parks because all our research is in national parks. Everybody goes to see wildlife in national parks. Nobody is looking at human use areas where agriculture is happening, where wildlife has always been. Because wildlife doesn't understand our national park boundaries. They go where they want to
yeah,
go.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah. So, for instance, you know, mob control, then making people more aware, because the fear, if you ask me, is the main reason why people, you know, go out of control. But when you increase understanding, then there is less fear and people know how to deal with the situation. For that, before a problem arises, you have to make people's understanding better. Right? Not when there's a problem, you can't go give them knowledge.
In like, yeah. See, little what I know, that means we'll say the elephant or the leopard is taking this route. So we avoid the route.
And take that's another route.
Another route.
Yeah. So we also spoke to a lot of communities who have traditionally been living with these animals and got some information from them. So they say that keep your surroundings clean, and that's an issue in India where we have a lot of garbage and dogs, and leopards come for the dogs.
So they like dogs.
They really like dogs in India. So, for instance, in Bombay, there's a small national park, but outside that, there's a huge amount of garbage because there are slums and bad disposal. So, the leopards are coming there to take the dogs, and then the people see them, and then there was tremendous pressure to trap and remove them. But what we realized very sadly was that when you capture an animal and leave it somewhere else, attacks on people start near these release sites. Because you're taking an animal that lives there, its home is there, and suddenly dumping it somewhere where there are other leopards, it doesn't know the place and it's hungry. And human beings use our landscapes so much. So it's different, like in Namibia where there are 2 people per square kilometer, you can take a leopard and dump it anywhere, it doesn't matter. But where you have like 500, 600 people per square kilometer using the landscape, you can't do that with a dangerous predator.
So you earlier saying about that some project in Bombay.
Right.
Can
so
you tell our viewers about this?
So in Bombay, between 2004 and 2005, there were nearly 30 attacks on people each year. And we realized later that it was because a lot of leopards were being captured and released in the Bombay area. Okay, because every time a leopard was seen, Bombay's all the politicians in their media, all the media houses are there. They're like, you know, put up man eater, even if it's not. So then a very good forest officer came, Mr. Limaye, and even consecutive officers as park directors, and we decided to have a program where citizens were involved. So it was not a leopard program. It was to make citizens more safer. And so anytime they see a leopard, like you'll see some amazing footages on YouTube where leopard is in a building running after a dog in the night.
Yeah, I've seen some of these in India, people surrounding.
So how to stop people from surrounding? So then the forest department opened up a control room. It trained its staff on rescue management. Then we realized the police are super important because to keep the crowd in control, nobody else can do it. Only the police can do it. So then the park director spoke to his ACP, Assistant Commissioner of Police. Then we had workshops with the police stations around the park, telling them we need your help. And so nowadays, it's beautifully done. Like a leopard is in a building society or something, it's cordoned off. The rescue team, which is well, you know, trained, well equipped, goes in, and within like an hour or so they have the leopard out with no casualties, no fatalities. So that is the way we should have started working, 30 years back.
Vidya, I'm not, that's a, because even though I'm from Sri Lanka, I'm not aware of it. In what's the leopard population in Sri Lanka and what's the leopard population in India?
So there is no real good count because leopards live a lot outside national parks. But they say that in India there are maybe about 14,000 leopards or so. And Sri Lanka, if I'm not mistaken, I was listening to some talks, I think you all have less than 1,000 leopards.
So that's really, that's not a good sign.
Yeah, it's a small number and that's why you have to
protect, take care
of it. Yeah.
But also, like, okay, now Sri Lankan leopards are world famous. People from all over the world come to see Sri Lankan leopards.
Yeah.
Why not the Indian leopard? There are more coming to Sri Lanka.
Yeah, because the Indian leopards are not as visible. So there is...
That's the reason.
Yeah, there's one place in India where they are really visible. It's outside a national park. It's called Javai in Rajasthan. There they have a lot of high-end tourism. Tourists come there to see the leopards.
Now, this is the interesting, like you say, I'm sure our viewers want to know. What do you think now? People see these spotted ones, you know, what's the difference? How do you differentiate between a leopard and a tiger? People are still confused.
Right, right. So, a leopard has rosettes, like it's a black circle like this.
Yeah.
Okay. And tigers have stripes.
Stripes.
And tigers are much bigger, almost double the size of leopards.
Yeah. But still there's a confusion. They see them and people say, oh,
tiger.
They're all tiger. That's...
No. So the tigers have stripes and the leopards have spots.
Yeah. No, but I'm pushing on this because still that knowledge is not there. Like people, when they see them, they are like, they don't look at those stripes and the spots. No, this is what I'm asking. I'm not saying about people like you all. Like people still have this confusion, isn't it?
Sometimes they do. And also I wonder, because in languages, like in Marathi, for instance, both of them are termed with the same word.
Yeah. We say Kotia. It should be Divya, you know, Kotia and Divya.
Divya is
the leopard and Kotia is the tiger.
Oh,
but still there is this.
I see.
The moment you see, okay, cheetah, you know?
Yeah.
And there's some people confused with cheetahs.
Yeah. So cheetahs are not found in India or Sri Lanka. So.
Yeah, but I've seen them I jump into a cheetah cage in Singapore.
Okay, yeah.
But of course, just to do an article for a magazine, but what they were telling me was, don't make eye contact.
I see.
So I didn't, you know, you could see me standing and, you know, they were all there. So if you make eye contact,
like you said, they
feel threatened.
Yeah.
That's
what they say. Yeah.
Any animal, for that matter.
Any wild animal, yes. If they are, I guess, I would say so.
Not to look at them, then they feel, that's the time they attack you.
Yeah. No, and also if you see a wild animal, your response should be not to go towards it, but to move away. They also do that. But if suddenly you're on a hill and you're coming this way and you're very close, then it's your duty to move away at the back. Just start walking backward.
So now, this distance,
you will not come so close, because normally, so another thing what we recommend is that in the night time, many of the farmers have to go to switch on their pumps in the leopard landscape.
Yes.
So we say you switch on the songs in your mobile phone.
Yes.
Because then the leopard will know from far away that a human is coming and it will move away.
Oh, so what you are saying is you have to give a warning.
You have to show your presence loudly.
And
the animals move away.
So they would not want to confront you.
They will not confront you. And never ever take a stick or pick up a stone to hit the animal.
Or throw it.
Or throw it. Even picking it up to do this, don't do it. Because even if you picked up a stone when I am standing, I am going to come and be aggressive with you. So don't be aggressive.
So, I know in Sri Lankan way, even the snakes, they say let them pass.
Yeah.
So you're saying these animals, reptiles, they understand.
No, the thing is, if any animal is worried for its life, it is going to
attack.
Because if its life is threatened, even I will attack you.
Yeah, that's even the human beings
so
will do.
Even a cat, if you corner a cat here, finished. So don't do that. Yeah.
So what she's saying, never to corner, let them live. I remember this famous
movie.
Let them move away.
Yeah.
But like you said, to just give that warning signal.
Beforehand, torch or sound. Another thing I would like to say, what we tell our farmers there, and they practice it by themselves, we learnt it from the farmers, is that if you are in a leopard landscape, they will like to eat goats, dogs and little calves.
Yes.
So keep, and night time is the time leopards use the landscape. So keep them protected in a good shed in the night. So then
so
you
they are, come for them.
That's yeah, they really come for them, and your losses then are zero if you protect your smaller livestock.
So that's really your advice to people, like especially when you went to Hatton and all these areas.
I didn't advise anybody, but this is
but
what
I'm sure they had their problems because we showed it even on our TV what these people were going through.
Yeah.
And they had these dogs tied and they came for the dogs and then they caught them.
Yeah. So it's best if you keep them in a small chain link fence, if you make for the night time, then they cannot get at them.
But they have the power, right, to break.
Not chain link. Chain link they can't. Yeah. If it is just made of sticks and all and there's one small hole, they will try to get in like a cat.
Yes.
Yeah. But if it's a chain link simple structure which is well put in the ground so they can't push it, then they won't. They'll try 2-3 times and they'll stop coming.
So that's, I mean, thank you very much, Vidya, for
thank you,
for joining Patikara. I'm sure, our viewers would, take your advice, give them a warning before they go. I mean, I have learned a lot from them. I mean, still, we have to learn a lot about them, like, but you said that they know, they understand better. I think, like you said, they work through instincts. If we also can work through instincts like them, we can coexist.
Yes.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Yeah. Have a wonderful day.
Yeah, thank you.
Athikada Bandura Jayasekara Samaga.